gentlemen, it's 3:01, and maybe we can begin the proceedings today. We have with us Professor Badri Narayan. He is also my neighbor at the South Asian Studies program, where he is the ICCR chair for this year. He's been with us since January and will be leaving at the end of May. Those of us at ICES have witnessed several talks from him. Just a few days ago, he spoke at a workshop on the Aam Aadmi Party, and just about a couple of days ago, we also had his inaugural lecture where he spoke on Videsya Bhav. Today, he's speaking on something else, and something in which he has published considerably on. Professor Badri will be speaking on a topic that's titled Memories, Identities, and Politics, Saffron Among Dalits. He's published several works in this area, and that includes a book on Kanchiram, the making of the Dalit public in North India, and a very interestingly titled book called Fascinating Hindutva that has an important place in my library, because I think it's a very important work on the Hindutva movement and its outreach on the Dalits. And that's precisely what I believe he's going to speak on today, in addition to the fact that he's currently the visiting ICCR chair. Of course, his full-time position is as professor of the G.B. Pant Social Science Institute at Allahabad, which I just recently found out has a very valuable archive on various aspects of Dalit society. He was recipient of the Fulbright Senior Fellowship and the Smarts Fellowship in 2004-05 and 2007 respectively. Now, before I hand over to him, could I first welcome the new director, who would like to say a few words to the audience today.
Thank you. I'm very grateful to be given a few minutes. I'm used to lecturing to large audiences. Shout at them, then they can shout at me. And occasions like this are very important for our institute for two reasons. You know, this is a signal to the world outside as to who we are and why we are here. It's also a signal to the stakeholders inside. How do we understand what binds us together, and how do we keep it vital and sustained? That is why I made it my business to go to every single lecture that is being organized by our institute, and I'm doing it at a certain cost. The opportunity cost is, if I were not doing this, I'd be pushing the frontiers of administration from 8th floor, which is actually my main job at the moment. I'm going to do this as well as do that, because the output from things like this, the intellectual value added, is what the whole world will recognize us with. Which is why I've also asked Rajesh to allow me kindly to open the discussion today. So after the talk, again, I'll say a couple of words, and then it will be up for grabs for all of you. Thank you.
Okay, without further ado, can we welcome our speaker today, Professor Badri Narayan.
Thank you, Rajesh. I'm really very thankful to ICES for providing me this opportunity to share some of my research experiences with you on Dalit politics, especially the Saffron mobilizations and how, what is happening, how Saffron forces, Hindutva forces are trying to mobilize Dalits. Dalit word, as you know, it's a quite popular word in academics. Especially Western academics, but not in villages. No one knows that they are Dalits. They know by themselves, by their sometimes their caste names, So scheduled caste is the government nomenclature for them, and Dalit came from the academics and especially political Ambedkar and all, you know, the history how this word came. But scheduled caste and you can untouchable group in India, 20% of the population all over the country comes under Dalit category, you can say. And in some states 30% they are, in some states 20% they are. So they constitute very powerful political group, or rather you can say the political community in Indian democracy. And when Congress, before 80, when these forces, these marginal forces were not very much aware about their identities, and the reservation politics and the representational politics were satisfying their identity needs. So that time they were not immersed as a very a strong claimant stakeholder of the democracy. But after 80, the new changes appeared in Indian society, and especially around 80s they started claiming their identities. And identity earlier also they were claiming, but not as a glorious identity. They were just accepting the identity given by the others. But around 80s they started creating or claiming their own identities on their own cost. But you know, it's very complex process. Identity making is a very complex process, and memory is the one of the very important constituent of the identity resource. Is very important identity resource which constitute identity. But memory is always, as you know, is very selective. Is not innocent. It's a very violent. It's a very contesting, and it's very evolving, changing. Everything happens. Memory is a very interesting domain. You know, that's another topic of discussion. I'm not going to delve in that. But I'm going to focus how Dalit movement in North India, especially in Uttar Pradesh, dealt with the memory of the Dalit communities, and how memory they used it as a political project, identity as a political project to mobilize votes in democratic politics. And mobilize community in democratic politics. What, how it happened? That's the main discussions which we are going to propose today. And there are two political parties who knows this game better than anyone. One is BJP, means RSS, not BJP, RSS. RSS is the main, you know, Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh, it is called. And other is the BSP, Bahujan Samaj Party, which is the party formed by Kanshiram. Mostly Dalit dominant party, and among Dalit also Chamar dominant party. So they both, and it's very interesting in this story, you can say, but this story about the RSS, but sometimes the BSP will come in that, because BSP and RSS claims they reinterpret the same myths in their own ways. How they use the same myth in their own ways for their own narrative, it's very interesting political game which happens in Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. So see, the field is Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, and the discussion about memory and identity as a political project to mobilize Dalit, how it happened. As you know, in 2014 elections, there was a lot of debates among psychologists and the political analysts that Dalit voted BJP in a big way in this election. That's why Modi became got so much seat. Although this observation or analysis was quite contesting that time also. Many journalists and many analysts were not agree with this analysis, because in Uttar Pradesh, where BSP is active, there Mayawati, who is the leader of BSP, got 19% vote of Dalits. There is a 21% Dalit population in Uttar Pradesh, and Mayawati got 19%, so she lost 2% among Dalits, from Dalit votes. But this 2% is also very critical, because Mayawati comes in power on 24-25% votes. And if she lose 2% vote of the whole community, it is a big loss for Mayawati. And in Bihar also, it's not the Dalit not move towards BJP in a big way. But slight movement, it also is a big indicator in democratic politics of India, because they were largely mobilized by the political forces against BJP. Because BJP were called like the party of the Brahmins, Banyas, and mostly urban sectors, the political party of the urban people. And they reached towards in the villages to Ram Janmabhoomi, and then the Modi development and the development and Hindutva worked together and came in the power. So because of that, the BJP entered in the this village sphere and especially Dalit sphere. And there are political analysts who proposes that it's happened because of anti-incumbency. It happened because of the aspirations of development. It happens because of the aspiring community has emerged among Dalits, and that's why they moved to the Modi, because Modi came with the development and Hindutva kind of slogan. But my analysis is that it's not so simple. It's because of long process of the mobilization of Dalits, which BJP and RSS were trying to do in the Indian society. That's why it happened. And it's not like magic. It's not like one day chemistry. It's the outcome of the long process. And what is the process which I'm going to tell you here? Process is is very interesting. Process is how earlier Dalits were, as I told you, they had accepted that they were lower caste, but RSS tried to use their desire to become appropriated among upper caste society. So self-respect as upper caste, as Brahminical, as a constituent of part and partial of the Brahminical culture, and it's a big desire among Dalits. Although there is a whole mobilization is against Brahminical culture, which Mayawati, Kanshiram, Ambedkar, they all did. But in spite of that, there is a strong desire among Dalits to become appropriated by the Brahminical culture or the higher caste culture, become higher caste. Become higher caste is a very big desire, important desire. It's very contradictory, but it's there. Like in one of in the village where we were walking, one Chamar guy, his name is Bhulla, he told me that we and Upparwala and Nichewala, we are meeting together, but Beachwala is creating problem. So Brahmin and Dalit, we are meeting together, but this Yadavs and the OBCs, because they are Samajwadi party who is opposing Mayawati, and they are creating problem. And this person is the voter of BSP, and he is the community leader of that village. So you can understand their desire. And if you many things one can say that they have a desire to become appropriated under this fold. And how this desire emerged? This desire emerged because of the certain reshaping of Dalit identity in certain form, certain way. And this happened through the Arya Samaji constructions of Dalit identities, which started during colonial time in around 1900, 1902 or 12. And the Arya Samaji missionaries started working among Dalits and trying to, Sanskrit, opening a school, the janeu, which they started giving janeu. But most important was that it's creating a narrative of their identity. First time Dalit got their identity narrative through Arya Samaj. They had no identity narrative, neither in Puran nor in Vedas. So who wrote their caste history? Caste history where the Arya Samaji activists wrote their caste history, and they got their caste history. How? I tell you the name of the few caste histories and the composer of those caste histories. The one Kshatriya work course prepared by Pandit Hardayal Sharma of Meerut in 1899, and in that he included a lot of Dalit caste as a Kshatriya caste. Then Nishad Vanshavali, written by Sri Devi Prasad, published in 1907. Then Kalwar Sanghita, is a Kalwar is again Dalit caste. Kalwar Sanghita, they are the winemakers. Kalwar Sanghita, in which Kalwars were projected as Kshatriya, was published in 1912. In the same series, also in 1912, our Samadhi Mathura Prasad Sharma published Mahalodhi Vivechana. Lodhi caste is OBC caste now. But Mahalodhi Vivechana, published from Nagpur. In 1914, Dilip Singh Yadav of Itawa composed Ahir Itihas Ki Jhalak. And then Darjiyo Ka Vansavali. No, they created their genealogy also. Darjiyo, Darji is a lower caste. Darjiyo Ki Vansavali, published from Badayun. Then Balmiki Vansi Darji, then Vamkul Vansi Darji, by Yadavans, and then Yadavans Kshatriyas. Then so many, I have given the two-paced note of this kind of booklets written by as a caste history by Arya Samaji missionaries, activists, and they gave the identity, actually identity always, as you know, as a, always given by others, and we accept and we then we recreate. And so this identity was given by Arya Samajis, and they accepted this identity. And another ways of another ways through which their identity were created by colonial writers, colonial ethnographers. They refer, even today they refer, that gazetteer mein itne page mein hamare baare mein likha hai ki hum raja the. We were the rajas of this area, and it's mentioned in the gazetteer. And then they say that so they use Arya Samaji narrative and also the narrative composed by the colonial authors, colonial ethnographers. They work as an important source for contemporary identity creation of Dalit mobilization in North India. And the basis, and there are two ways of this identity construction. On the one way, through RSS mobilization, they project themselves as a higher caste. But in BSP mobilization, they project themselves that we were Rajas, or we were Gyanis, because Chamar called themselves Gyanis. They love to call themselves like Pandit. They are the Pandit of the Dalit caste. They perceive themselves like that. We were Gyanis, and in our vansh, there were Super Rishi, and there were so many like Ravidas, and this kind of people came in our vansh, and we were Gyanis. They never claim as martial race, but the Parsi is the second community, largest community, they claim as martial race. So they link themselves with the Rajas. We were Raja, and because of the Brahminical conspiracy, we were thrown out from the state. And we have the caliber to rule the state. We have tradition to rule the state, that's why we need power. And the whole argument is that we are the community who are made to rule. And but we were thrown from the power by the middle class, the Brahminical conspiracy, and somewhere the Muslim conspiracy in the RSS story, because of the Muslim conspiracy, the medieval time, we were dispossessed from the power because of the Muslim scheme, and they dispossessed us from the power. So gun goes against Muslims, and here gun goes against Brahmins. So both the same narrative, you can say, used in different way, in different directions. And then, so that's the memory constructions among Dalits. Now you are seeing how it's going on. And RSS usually was the party, the group of Hindutva force who were working in the urban areas earlier. But as you know, the history, how they moved to the villages, Ram Janmabhoomi movement and all. And there is a very interesting book written by VHP, General Secretary of, now he's no more, he expired recently. His name is Ramji Bhai. You know, Ramji Bhai wrote a book, a small book, Bharat Ka Gaon Kaisa Ho. So they had the whole, this is a big project of remaking of Indian villages, और भारत का गांव कैसा हो, एंड दैट ही प्रपोज दैट आई ही प्रपोज द विलेज व्हिच ही हैज इन हिज मेमोरी दैट इन माय चाइल्डहुड एज आई सॉ दैट हाउ दलित एंड ब्राह्मण एंड द छात्र fought together against Muslims. So why can't we create this kind of village even now? So the whole project of remaking of Indian village, in which Dalit fight as a soldier of upper caste against Muslims. Mm. So they want the whole the politics of the whole mobilization is this, and that came from the Ramji Bhai kind of discourse, which Ramji Bhai, Ashok Singhal, and then the so many from RSS, they have wrote book on Dalit, how to mobilize them, how to work with them. And in those books, they have proposed their models, and then these models are in the same line. So, the village space, which was not Saffronized before 80s, after 80s, it slowly started getting Saffronized. What they started doing? They started some Rasta campaign. Some Rasta campaign, as you know, the eating together with Dalits. Eating, dying together, with Dalits. The khichdi, you know, they make a kind of food, khichdi, and they sit with the Dalits and eat together. So one, this is the very popular form of RSS mobilization, is organizing Samrasta Ghosh in Dalit Patti. And they started it from Banaras, where the Dom Raja of Banaras, they invited Dom Raja, as you know, the Banaras, the king of the Banaras was Dom. And they invited Dom Raja with Bala Sahab Devras, and both ate together in the same thali. You must have seen today, recently Rajnath Singh ate roti ka tukda given by Dalit women. So this, and when Rahul Gandhi started eating with the Dalit family, they started creating a lot of attack on him, that what he is doing is tourism, it's Dalit tourism. But in their politics, it's very central, Samrasta Ghosh. And then Ghar Vapsi, you have seen the Ghar Vapsi is for happening today, is the extension of Samrasta Ghosh. Because they believe that Dalit are, either they believe or not, they argue that Dalit were not separated from the upper caste. They had a respect in our society, but due to the medieval time, when the Muslims invaded our society, it created a lot of fear in our society. And because of that, we created a lot of barriers. And that's why Dalits became discriminated. So the cause of discrimination is not the Hindu system. The cause of discrimination is the invasion of Muslims in India. So the whole history which they started creating, and the history they create and they publish from the Nagpur. If you go in Nagpur, thousands of small booklets written on Dalit caste. And they distribute in the villages when they go to organize Samrasta Bhoj. It's not only Samrasta Bhoj. After Samrasta Bhoj, they give booklets, the posters, and they organize games that day. Well, games Khel Kusti, the wrestling competitions with the Saffron flag, in which they invite the wrestlers from different parts of the villages and give them awards and speeches, and everything happens. So it's a composite, a package of discourse in which celebrations, then food, forming communities, discourse, booklets, you know, everything worked together. So the villages, schools, the bagichas, they are all the place where earlier it was a secular space and the space for just village space, rather secular, neither secular nor communal, so village space, now became Saffron space slowly in the northern part of India. So it's not one day process, it's a very long process. Then they started weekly meeting in those areas where they created a central base of their politics. And then schools, a lot of schools they opened for Dalits. Banwasi Kalyan Ashram, Banwasi schools, you know, Ekal schools, Eklabing schools, and then lot of schools, lot of small NGOs. RSS had more than 2,000-3,000 NGOs. So people don't know about them. They know about only RSS. And no one has documented the way RSS work in the villages and the Indian society. Another problem of understanding RSS is, intellectually understanding of RSS is, they are very fixed, like Walter Anderson, you know, see his book, or Vish Raj Goyal, or Jeff Law and others, and VHP. They are all fixed in a time, because they documented in certain time to the activity of the RSS. But RSS is every day growing, and every day they are developing new strategy to incorporate the groups and communities. So more than 2,000-3,000 NGOs are working. Recently they organized conference of those NGOs, and Ajim Premji addressed that meeting of the NGOs, of the RSS NGO. So this kind of the charity activities, you know, through charity activities, through various kinds of that they just show that they are RSS groups. Like you know, Saraswati Shishu Mandir is RSS schools, but there are so many schools who are not under the banner of Saraswati Shishu Mandir, but they are RSS schools. They are funded by the RSS. RSS people are working in that those schools, and they are doing different kinds of pedagogic intervention to saffronize the minds of the children and the schools. So that's the then the. Funding, as you know, the to fund this kind of activities, how from where it comes, and NNIs are one of the very important clusters is to support deterritorialization. How supported Hindutva forces? Arjuna Padre had a wonderful comment about that, and we talked about that in a big way. So. Then the another strategy through which they intervened in the identity constructions of Dalit and through is exploring Dalit heroes from oral histories, from oral narratives, and they like the Daldev Pasi, no? Baldev Pasi. Baldev Pasi was known as the founder of Bareilly. Lakhan Pasi, they say that Lucknow is named after Lakhan Pasi, who was a king of Lucknow. That's his name, Lakhan. So Lucknow became on the name of Lakhan. So Lakhan Pasi story, Daldev Pasi story. They organized celebrations. They organized Jayantis on the birthday of the Lakhan Pasi. And it's very interesting, the last UP election, BJP and BSP both published their manifesto. And in that manifesto, they declared that when we will come in power, we will start holiday on the Jayantis of Daldev Pasi, Baldev Pasi, Lakhan Pasi, and this Supachrishi, and and both BJP and RSS, BJP and BSP both, same hero, same narrative, but so claim made by both BJP and RSS and BSP on the same cultural symbol, but in their own way. So they explored those heroes and started in those celebrations. It's very interesting to know, Ashok Singhal used to go, the Prant Pracharak comes there, big leaders of the RSS comes. For them it's not non-important activities that the way Congress and other party takes considered. For them it's very important, because Dalit is a very important critical community for them. So and what they do, they link these heroes in their narrative through Ram, no? Because for them the concept is the Ram Raj, and Ram Raj, how Ram Raj, what was Ram Raj? Everyone, daihik, daivik, bhautik, tapa, Ram Raj, kahu nahi vyapa. Ram Raj, there was no discrimination. So Dalit and the Brahmins were together. So they narrate the Ram story in their own way. In the meetings, we have documented their story, how they narrate, because one of my research assistants joined RSS 10 years ago when we started working on that, and he is still with RSS. So we have tried to capture the inner story, how they work, And but it's really that's another story from where you can go after certain time, certain stage, you can't get information. That's a different problem. But so how they tell this narrative that Bandar Bhalu, these monkeys, they are symbol of Dalits, and they were the Ram army. So Ram got success because of them. And when Ram came from back from the Lanka, so he always kept with him Hanuman as advisor. So Dalit, so he never left them. He brought the Hanuman with him. So Dalit and Ram, it means Bandar and Ram, monkey and Ram, had a close organic relation. So why not Dalit and me? We means the Dalit and upper caste, and because their politics is identified like that. So these kind of stories, Angad, Jamwant, Hanuman, and they created theater. They composed some theaters based on this kind of narrative, and they performed these theaters during these celebrations. So since celebrations, Jayantis of these Dalit heroes, on that day they also organized theater, Samrasta Bhoj, then the Khel Kushti competitions. So in various through different means they try to capture the Dalit mind. They also tell in the stories that Maharana Pratap, when he was fighting against Akbar, then tribals helped him, Dalit helped him. So why not we fight together? So the Muslim the middle period history of the medieval period, they put against Dalit. And they try to create the full relationship between upper caste, Dharmical communities, and the Dalits. So Paharis, Banvasis, Bawalis, they give names. These are the castes who supported Rana Pratap. So they do a lot of research and bring these kinds of names and put it in their narrative. They say that, I'm telling you the narrative through which they create memory and identity, because it's not very old memory. Memory is not older. It's a new memory, always claimed as old, invention of tradition kind of thing, that it's a new thing, but always claimed as old. So they say that in communal rights, Dalit used to kill in a big way. Why? Because they fight for the community, they fight for the Hindutva. So they are the army of the Hindutva, and they are the protector of the Hindutva, not Brahmin, not middle caste. They are the real people, they are the real Hindus. So the Ghar Vapsi is the extension of that logic, that they are saying those who are in other caste, other religion, they are also from Dalit communities, and they are Hindus, so they should come back. So Ghar Vapsi thing is going on. So communal right narratives, they use in their own way. And then they don't use this word Dalit, they use word Vanchit. Because Dalit is Vanchit is a very passive word to denote Dalits. Vanchit, V-A-N-C-H-I-T, Vanchit. Vanchit means those who are deprived, but they can't assert. Dalit can assert. Dalit is deprived, but Dalit can assert, because the meaning of the word Dalit contains a kind of political action also. But in Vanchit there is no action, and they consciously and they deliberately they argue for that. Don't tell Dalit. Don't tell us. Tell Vanchit. So Vanchit has its own politics. How they use? Why they use Vanchit? So these local myths which they explore, and they organize celebrations and all, and create a new memory among Dalits, they link these local myths with the Ram, because they believe that in every caste, they tell one of the leader of the Ram Janmabhoomi movement, Ram Vilas Vedanti, he tells in one of his statements that Ram born in every caste, there are so many Ram. And Ram born in every caste in various forms. So Dalit heroes to whom they pick up, they prove that look, this the hero has a quality like Ram. So why you are not serving for Ram politics? So the BJP politics has Ram politics, and they say that during Ram Janmabhoomi movement, when Mulayam Singh had stopped the wheels to go to Ayodhya because of Karsevak, to stop Karsevak, that time Nishads and many Dalit community, they helped Karsevak to cross Sarju River and entered in Ayodhya through different paths. So this and they say why they did and why they should do, because they were the army of they were in the army of Ram. Who helped Ram to cross river? Nishad Raj.
Mm-hmm.
And Nishad Raj Guhe. Nishad Raj Guhe. And Nishad Raj Guhe is the very very respectable symbol among Nishads. So Nishads can do anything for the. They also celebrate Nishad Raj Jayanti. RSS celebrate Nishad Raj Jayanti. So you can see how they have picked up these heroes and used it for political mobilizations and convincing communities. And linking with the Ram. So one is Nishad Raj. Second is Mushahar, as you know, the red pickers community. It's a very low caste community, mostly in Bihar and Uttar Pradesh. They are very in good numbers, and they are red teachers. And they have the heroes Dina Bhadri. Dina Bhadri, they are the heroes of the land struggle. In fact, the Mushahar caste used to dig land and create tank, talab. The ponds, they used to create ponds, and in the process of for creating ponds, they used to dig land, which is towards their caste division. So they fought for, they were in fact fought for the land to make ponds, because pond is linked with their occupation. But RSS picked up, and BJP picked up this myth, and they tried to prove that Ajaram, who was Ram, Dina Bhadri, were the Ram of the community, and how he fought. How he so the whole story they have recreated. They created audio cassettes, you know, video cassettes. They organize performance of the singers. They invite singers who sings the ballad of Dina Bhadri, and they document those the singing in their own narrative, and they disseminate with the communities. They distribute freely in the free without any free to the community. So similarly, they have picked up two other myths. One is Sahlesh myth, very popular among Dushads of Bihar. And Dushads and Sahlesh was also very revolutionary, radical myth for Dalit history. But they have used it for the RSS mobilization. And now Sahlesh became like Brahmins. No? The whole ritual of the Sahlesh puja, in every Dalit patti, in Bihar, there is a Sahlesh temple you can find. There is a Sahlesh Thaan. Earlier it was Thaan, now it's Them temple. And earlier it had a very Dalit kinds of ritual, no? Not Brahminical. Now they have elaborate, very Brahminical kind of ritual. And the whole recreation of narrative you can see to recreate the Sahlesh story as the Ram of the community. And similarly, there is another very interesting myth that is, you know, in Bahraich in Uttar Pradesh, there is a Gazi Mia temple, Khan of Gazi Mia. And Gazi Mia was a Muslim the commander who came in Uttar Pradesh. And there he fell in love with a UP, the girl from that region. There he was killed by one of the, in a story, one of the Bhar Raja of that area, Bhar Raja Suhaldev. Bhar was, no one knows Bhar was either Parsi or not, but now Parsi claims that he was from our family, our bunch. So Suhaldev, who killed Gazi Mia, Gazi Mia myth is very popular among Dalits and Odissans. And everyone goes to worship him. It's a big the place for worship of Dalits and Gobises of Hindu caste. He is a Muslim myth, he was Sufi, it's also called he's a Sufi. There is a lot of various kinds of myth he has. One myth is the Sufi, one myth is that he was he felt in love and married with the local girl. So the marriage story, Shahid Amin is working on that myth. But the interesting part of this story is that RSS explored another myth, and that is the Suhaldev myth. They were saying that Gazi Mia was a Muslim invader and that people go and worship him. It's wrong, they should not worship him, and Hindus should not go there. They should come to the Suhaldev statue. And they established Suhaldev Mandir, temple, statues, the ponds, then the ritual, and they created the Suhal Devas as a hero of Dharma Rakshak, Rashtra Rakshak, and Desh Rakshak, Suhal Dev. So Suhal Dev, who was a local Raja of that area, he was by caste Bhar, we don't know if he was a Dalit or not, but now became Dalit hero and then the Dharma Rakshak, Rashtra Rakshak of the RSS. And RSS, the control, whole ritual process, whole puja process of that. And not only this, these are the those who are involved in this politics, they were given political tickets, political representation by the BJP in the elections. So mobilization on the cultural line and also providing the political space to contest elections and get the... So these myths were not immersed within the history of 10 or 20 years. The Suhal Dev is the emerging making of the history of the making of Suhal Dev myth started 1940s when the Ram Raj movement, Ram Raj organization, the VHP movement, lot of Arya Samaj movement. Actually, RSS got symbolic capital created by these kind of political forces who started their politics around 40s. Like this Gauraksha movement, various kinds of movement, Swami Karpatriji movement, the movements, through various channels, a symbolic capital were created, and RSS, based on those symbolic capital, recreated their politics, which is the history of 30, 40 years. They started around 80s to mobilize Dalits, and now they are very successful in mobilizing them. In recent election, here I'll finish. First time RSS formed booths. The first time RSS mobilized the elections in an open way, openly. The earlier RSS were working behind the scene. This time they came on the floor and they controlled the whole election process. And there was no difference between RSS office and BJP office. RSS leader are in BJP office, BJP leader are in RSS office. If you go that time, you can see. It's very visible. So RSS formed a booth level committee this time. And in that, they 10 members. And 10 members, they based on the caste of that region. If in that village, Chamar is in a big number, so they put Chamar in a big number in that that booth committee. So it was very caste-based booth committee, and 2 years, all two years, Amit Shah, who was in charge of Uttar Pradesh, he visited all caste associations meetings organized by marginals and OBC groups, and he attended, he intervened, and he also went to this kind of the celebrations, he took part in that. And through that, they got this kind of support from Dalits, either 3% or 4% or 2% or 1% or 6%. Mayawati lost or not, that's not the issue, but Dalit tilt was there in this election. We don't know whether it will continue or not, because BSP is constantly trying to attack on this kind of process of mobilization through their own narrative. This is the war of narrative, rather you can say. It's a war of narrative, war of memories. And both are trying to mobilize Dalit based on their identity requirement and identity urge and through their identity symbols, and that's the whole story, and here I'm going to finish it.